for that control mass is greater than or equal to the heat transfer, the net heat transfer, the net reversible heat transfer, over the temperature at which that heat transfer occurs. And there are a couple things. One is, what's reversible heat transfer? Is perfect heat transfer? There's no such thing, but even perfect heat transfer has entropy associated with it. But another point here is that work is not associated with entropy. At least perfect work is not. Now, imperfect work is, because imperfect work has friction, but friction has heating. And so it's really the heat transfer from the imperfect work that's associated with entropy generation. We can rewrite this form as S2 minus S1 for that control mass is greater than or equal to, sorry, I'm getting all jammed up here, the net heat transfer that's reversible. And we want the sum of the heat transfers over temperature, because there might be several, sorry, this is getting jammed up, the sum of the changes in the heat transfer that's reversible over temperature. So let me write this out a little bit better for you. And that is greater than or equal to the Qin over Tn minus Qout over T out. But the net heat transfer, I mean, there's a net heat transfer is the sum of all the heat transfers, the sum heat transfer in, some heat transfer out. And the net is the sum of the Qn minus the Q out over the temperature at which that heat transfer occurs. The heat transfer might occur at a different location, and the temperature might be different at that location. So this is the second law that we did before. And by the way, this is all reversible heat transfer every time. So that's reversible heat transfer. And we can change this greater than or equal sign to be an equal sign by creating a term, the entropy generated. So we can change the greater or equal sign to an equal sign by including a term, Sgen, which is the entropy that's generated. And then in that case, we get the change in entropy, S2 minus S1, for that control mass equals the heat transfer in minus the heat transfer out over the temperatures at which they occur plus the entropy generation term. So you call this change in entropy the observed change in entropy. The change entropy associated with reversible heat transfer, and the entropy generation, which is from irreversibilities. So this is the second law with a little more clarity compared to how we did it before. By the way, you often want to find out what's the entropy that's generated. How crazy is the system? How much entropy does it generate? And so you can just rework that to be the entropy generated equals the change in entropy for the control mass, S2 minus S1, minus the Qn over Tn minus Qout. This is where it gets messy. Qout over Tout. And so you'll have a minus minus term. You gotta watch out. So we have this relationship with the second law that the change entropy is greater than or equal to zero. We know it's greater than zero for an isolated system. And it's greater than zero for a closed system. Depends on which way the heat transfer goes. But we can make that inequality rather than inequality by using this irreversibility term, this fudge factor, this term. They're like, well, we know this other entropy, we don't know what it is, so we'll call it irreversibility. The generated entropy, which must be the difference between all of them. Either times where you want to calculate the generated entropy. So that's a recap of what we've done before. Looks like that. Any questions on that before I go on to open the system? Yes?
Is that next to Qnet reversible? Is that an integral sign or a?
This is a differential. Little delta Q. It's really a heat transfer. It's not like we always draw it as one arrow coming in. Really, heat transfer comes in around the whole body with a bunch of little small heat transfers. So it's the sum of the small heat transfers. Good question.
So for control mass,
aspect, there's only heat. Are we assuming there's no work?
You could have work. You could be compressing it, or you could have shaft work. But there's no entropy associated with that work. So we I think we showed like two lectures ago for a PDD system that there's no entropy generation for.
That's right.
Using Gibbs equations, we went through, and for PDD work, there's no entropy associated with that work. But even perfect heat transfer has entropy associated with it. So I tend to think of entropy with heat transfer and with temperature and that kind of thing. Temperature changes, delta T should have entropy associated with it. Changes the heat flows have entropy associated with it, but work might not. Work doesn't. Except for the comments made, imperfect work that has losses due to friction of entropy, but that friction is generating heat. Any other questions? Now we're going to open system. So the second law for control masses here is closest mass to expand that to an open system. We have some system. Wherever it is, we have some Q in, at T in, we have some Q out, at T out. We might have some mass flow in that has entropy, and then we have some, oops, I heard that the wrong way. This should be out, some S in and some S out. So we have an open system. And we can imagine that the entropy in the system might change. So in this case, the S2 minus S1 for your control volume, which is your open system, is the entropy you add minus the entropy you lose because of mass flow plus the sum of Qn over Tn minus the sum of Qout over Tout plus the entropy that's generated. And this S in, S out is with mass flow. You can have mass flow into or out of a system, and just like that mass takes enthalpy, that mass can take entropy. You can have that mass bring entropy in, that mass can take entropy out. Then you have your heat transfer in and out, which has entropy, and then you have your entropy that's generated. So, these heat transfers are a reversible heat transfer, and then this generation term is from your irreversibility. Please see my notes. I thought you said that was irritability. That's irreversibility. It's irritable entropy. Really angry. And the key here is that you can lose, you can actually have a system that loses entropy. So we tend to get stuck in this idea that entropy goes up, and entropy does go up for an isolated system. But entropy can go down for a non-isolated system. Let's take a system. It's got a bunch of stuff in it, a bunch of gas or a bunch of water, whatever it is. There's entropy associated with that system. We evacuate the system, we empty it. We send all that mass out of the system, the entropy goes with it, and then it's a vacuum, and then it's empty. Well, that vacuum has less entropy when you're done because it doesn't have anything in it. So it's possible for a system to have less entropy when it's done, but only if it's open, or if you have exchange, you send everything out. You can do the same thing with heat transfer, you can send all your heat out. But then your whole system, if you draw your universe around that cooler or whatever it was, the entropy goes up for that. So the whole universe, entropy goes up. For your isolated system, entropy goes up. But for your open system, entropy can actually go down if you're sending the entropy out. It's very important. Let me get that. Do you want me to say it again? Yeah. Okay, so entropy goes up for a process for an isolated system. Entropy goes up for a process for the universe. But for your small system, which might be a tank or a cooler or something like that, where you're depleting the mass and sending the mass out, you're draining a tank or you're emptying a balloon or something like that, the entropy goes with the mass out of the system. You can actually have lower entropy at the end than it started with because you've evacuated it, you got rid of stuff. Now, you probably added entropy from the irreversibility, but you might lose more entropy from the mass that went out. Jeff has a question.
I was just saying, you have to be working to decrease entropy in the system,
but
the universe went up.
Yeah, that's right. So as you deplete your entropy from your tank, it's going into the universe or the environment, and the entropy is going up over there. So you look at the entropy that went up over here and went down over here. It went more up over here than here. So in total, entropy went up, but for your one smaller system, it can go down.
And in total, it will always go up.
And in total, it always goes up. Yeah. In total, for the whole universe. Any questions about that? That's kind of a key concept. This is for the open system. This looks like the energy balance. The energy you have at the end is equal to what you started with plus what you added minus what you took out. But then we have these other terms where there's other ways to get into the system through the heat transfer and through the generation of it.
Dr. Weber, you know how when we had the similar formula for work and heat and then that we could assume work in and heat out or heat in and work out? Can we do a similar thing and will it always work out?
No, so for this one, it'd be nice to know the direction. Well, so let me back up. Yes, you do the same thing, and if you're wrong, your signs should tell you. So you'll use your energy balance to get your signs before you get to this point, usually. And then you should know what your signs are. Because if you don't know your signs, it's hard to calculate the entropy if you know which way it's going. So the energy balance will tell you whether it's in or out. If you guess in, it turns out it's out, then your in will be a negative in, which means it's out. But then you have to plug it in with the proper sign here. If you're not sure whether your S is in or out, you think it's just one in, you could guess S in, but then you should find a negative S in with 3 S out. So in these terms, you could do that. But for the Q, you really want to know which direction the Q is before you get to this state. And you use your energy balance to get to that. You use your mass balance to figure out which direction S in and S out is as well. That's a good question. All right, let's put this on a rate basis. The change in time of your entropy for your control volume equals the rate at which you add your entropy minus the rate at which you take it out. Those are weird S's. Those are supposed to be S's with hatches. Plus the sum of the net heat transfer, which is kind of confusing, over the temperatures at which they occur, plus the rate of entropy generation. So rate basis, what's the change of the entropy, the control volume over time? Well, it depends on how quickly you're adding entropy, how quickly you're taking it away, and how quickly you're adding or taking it away with heat transfer, and then the rate at which you're generating it because of irreversibilities. We can have a steady flow, steady state system, in which case the change in entropy over time equals zero. In that case, we can scratch out that term, and we get the rate of entropy generation is equal to S dot out minus S dot in minus the sum of the heat transfer rates over the temperatures at which they occur. I've just taken the SDN, I've taken these terms to the other side and set that to zero. For steady flow, steady state, the rate at which you change the entropy of the system is zero. Not change the entropy, but it comes in just as quickly as it leaves. So it's similar to steady flow, steady state for the energy balance.
Something be steady state, steady flow for energy and unsteady state?
It's sort of steady flow, steady state means it's not accumulating mass or energy. And so if you're not accumulating mass or energy, you're not accumulating entropy either. Their entropy might be going up in the universe, but not in your system. Those are a couple problems to show you how to do this. All right, there's a turbine in the upper left. Okay, we're going to do problem 6127. Kind of hard to read this. I should be pretty good one, but I didn't do it. Turbine, upper left. You got inlet conditions, 8 megapascals, 450 C. Exit conditions, this is a steam turbine, 50 kilopascals of saturated vapor. It gives you work out at a rate of 4 megawatts because turbines give you power out. Steam expands in a turbine steadily at a rate of 25,000 kilograms per hour. That's the mass flow rate, kilograms per hour, which is not the same as kilograms per second, entering at 8 megapascals at 453 degrees Celsius and leaving at 50 kilopascals as a saturated vapor, so we're quality one. If the power generated by the turbine is 4 megawatts, determine the rate of entropy generation for this process. Assume the surrounding medium is 25 degrees Celsius, and the answer is 8.38 kilowatts per Kelvin. So let me erase the board while I write that down, and we'll solve it. steam turbine, problem 6127. And this is from a different book, by the way, so this is not in the app. Steam turbine. And a steady flow, steady state steam turbine. Most turbines are steady flow, steady state. We're given a couple things. We're given a mass flow rate. Equals 25,000 kilograms per hour, which equals 6.94 kilograms per second. So I'm just parroting the math on that, just converting from hours to seconds. We're given conditions of state one. We're given pressure one is 8 megapascals. We're given T1 equals 450 degrees Celsius. You guys are experts at this now. You'll figure out pretty quickly that's superheated vapor. And that gives you H1 and S1 from table 12S. Can I bring this over on me? So the table, I don't have the online one here, but table 12, superheat steam. People look up the kilopascals, I'm at the wrong page. Here you go. We've got the pressure, temperature, and there's an entropy listing, and it'll be listing. So some tables give you entropy. Some tables give you S0, which is used for different ideal gas relations. So you go straight to the table to get this value. And at state two, you know it's a saturated vapor, which means quality equals one, at 50 kilopascals. And from that, you can get H2 and S2. You get the full properties. We know the rate of work out equals 4,000 kilowatts. And we know temperature of the surroundings equals 25 degrees Celsius, which equals 298 Kelvin. Don't forget, convert Celsius to Kelvin. And we want to find the rate of entropy generation. We can assume different things. In this case, based on the problem definition, we can assume steady flow, steady state. We can assume negligible changes in kinetic potential energy. Cannot assume adiabatic. There's no reason in this case, we're not sure, so we're not told it's insulated or anything like that, so we're not sure it's adiabatic. Do mass balance on it. So the process for the entropy is you still do the mass balance first, you still do the energy balance second, then you get to the second one. Let's start with the mass balance. Mass balance, steady flow, steady state. That means mass flow rate in equals a mass flow rate two. That's pretty easy. We can call that just the mass flow rate, which we're already given. Energy balance, the rate of energy in equals the rate of energy out. Now it's really the rate of change of energy in the system equals the rate of energy in minus energy out, but the rate of the energy changing in the system is zero. And we can see that minus Q dot out minus work dot out plus M dot H1 minus H2 equals zero. I'm skipping some of the algebra. No, you can go back and solve this later. You have energy coming in for the mass coming in and bringing in the other place. You got an energy in term. And three energy outs. So heat out, work out, and the mass flow rate out. Can you put your phone down? Your Q out, 1 to 2, equals your mass flow rate, H1 to H2 minus work dot out. And it turns out that it's not equal to zero. That Q is a positive. Q out is positive. Not unusual for a turbine to be hot, the radiate heat away. Although if you're told it's insulated or anything about it, you can assume that as well. All right, so we've done mass balance and energy balance. We've got an expression for Q. We want this expression for Q because the second law depends on Q. So we want to find out if it's zero or not. And then we can do our second law using the same expression I just showed you,
the rate of entropy generation equals the rate of entropy out minus the rate of entropy in minus the sum of the Q net over Ti and Q net, Q dot net, equals Q dot in minus Q dot out. But look, this is a minus Q dot out and a minus sign. You have double negative, you gotta keep track of in there. And so the rate of entropy generation, which is your mass flow rate, times S2 minus S1, minus negative Q dot out over your temperature of your surroundings. We got a negative negative Q dot out over the temperature of the surroundings in Kelvin. Put in some numbers. H1 equals, I'm putting these, giving these to you so you can go solve it on yourself as you prepare for the next quiz that you can. So H1 is 3272 kilojoules per kilogram. H2 is 2646 kilojoules per kilogram. Entropy 1 equals 6.555 kilojoules per kilograms Kelvin. And S2 equals 7.594 kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. Q dot out equals 344 kilojoules per second. And that means your rate of entropy generation equals 6.94 times 7.594 minus 6.555 minus 344 over 298. Okay, so this is our mass flow rate, S2, S1, Q out over T surroundings. And that works out to be 8.37 kilowatts Kelvin, which is kilojoules per second Kelvin. So for a second law problem, you still have to know the first law, you still have to do your mass balance, you still have to define your system, you still have to do your energy balance, and then you use the second law as well to get a sense for what the entropy generation is. Any questions on that? I've got another couple examples I'll show you. I know it's fast, I just threw a lot of stuff up there. Yes?
How do you know, like, you know the temperature under the Q net? Why is it the temperature of the surroundings? Is that because we were saying that the out, like the temperature out is equal to the temperature?
The temperature, well, in this case, it's actually, in the real world, very complicated because the temperature changes over the boundary as the heat transfer occurs. And as you get into heat transfer more deeply, you'll learn equations for that as well. And so in this case, we're just looking at a big heat sink, the atmosphere or the ocean, whatever the surroundings are, that are at a stable temperature, and heat transfer occurs at that point at that temperature. And it might be going into something else that's at a lower temperature, but we define it at the boundary where the heat transfer occurs. But it's really tricky because you're like, well, it's cooler inside, use that temperature now, so we tend to use the surrounding, we use the bath around it, the environment around it for the temperature. Just by the way, the definition of how the equations were set up. But that gets really tricky really quickly. We tend to give you a hint, like the surroundings are at XYZ temperature, that's usually a hint of how we want you to use it. Yes?
Does Q out have a negative sign in that equation
that's
out?
The Q, we defined the Q out with an arrow out the way I set up the equation. And so Q out equals 344. But then the second law gets minus Q net. And Q net is Q in minus Q out. So you have a negative here and a negative there. So I could have, instead of defining it as minus Q net, I could have said plus Q out minus Q in. But Q net is often defined as Q in minus Q out. It gets tricky. It kind of doesn't matter as long as you define a certain way that are very consistent. Any other questions on that before we go on? Yes?
What book is this from?
Oh, this is Chengel and Bowles, third edition.
Oh.
So this Moran and Shapiro is a famous thermodynamics book, and then this is another one of the famous books that's out there. There's like four thermo books that the world uses for this part.
Soon to be five MRAs.
What's it?
Soon to be five.
Soon to be five, exactly. Soon to be one, and all the other four are learning. Like your attitude, it's good, yeah. Take your learn. All right, so let's take another problem. Let's take a problem 6132. Is that on here? Okay, 6132. Air enters a compressor. So look at 32 at the bottom. Air enters a compressor at ambient conditions of 15 psi, 60 degrees Fahrenheit at a low velocity. Exits at 150 psi, 620 Fahrenheit, and 350 feet per second. The compressor is cooled by the ambient air at 60 degrees Fahrenheit. Come to your question. The ambient air at 60 degrees Fahrenheit. That's a hint what the surroundings are. At a rate of 1500 BTU per minute. The power input to the compressor. Excuse me, it's 400 horsepower, determine the mass flow rate of air and the rate of entropy generation. All right, mass flow rate that applies first law, rate of entropy generation that applies second law. And this is the air compressor. It's a compressor, so it's set close to the state. Let's draw it. We have conditions one, conditions two. You have some work in. You have some U out. And we're given work dot in, Q dot out, and T of the outside. We're given the inlet conditions T1, P1, the velocity is around zero at state one. We're given T2 and P2 and V2 equals some number not equal to zero. We want to find the mass flow rate and the rate of entropy generation. And we can assume a couple things. It's air at ambient conditions, so it's ideal gas, so we can use the air tables. Negligible potential energy, negligible kinetic energy at state one, but not at state two, and steady flow, steady state. For the mass balance, mass comes in equals the mass that goes out. That's what we want to find. The energy balance gets a little trickier. The energy balance, you have your energy rate in equals your energy rate out, because there's no accumulation of energy in the system. And your rate of energy in is your work in, the compressor takes work, and your rate of energy out is Q dot out, plus your M dot H1 minus H2, minus M dot V2 squared over 2GC. You have some kinetic energy that leaves with it as well. Plus. We want to find M dot, and we can find H1 and H2 from the tables, and we're given Q dot out and work dot out, so this gives us M dot. So we can find M dot from the first law in doing the balances. We just look up H from the air tables. Now we got to use the second law to find entropy generation. The rate of change for the entropy in the control volume equals the rate of entropy in, the rate of entropy out, plus Q net over T, plus the rate of entropy generation. But because of steady flow, steady state, the change in entropy for the control volume is zero. And so we can rearrange this to get the rate of entropy generation equals M dot, it's minus M dot, S2 minus S1, because I flip the signs, minus a negative Q dot out over T which we're given the T for the surroundings. So we're combining many things, mass balance, energy balance, second law, yeah.
Why is it H1 minus H2?
Right here?
Yeah.
Well, you have, did I flip a sign on this? It might be H2 minus H1. M dot H1, this would be H2 minus H1. Is that a little more agreeable to you guys? Okay, thank you, make a note of that. Take my notes so I don't make this mistake again. Okay, and S2 minus S1, by the way, we went through like a week ago or so, for air equals S0.2 at T2 minus S0.1 at T1 minus R bar over M ln P2 T1. This is a hard problem. You gotta use your mass balance, your energy balance, your assumptions, use your steady flow, steady state, clear out some terms. You still get a difference in S2 minus S1, but you can look up in the gas tables, in the air tables, you're given S naughts, and we have this relationship from Gibbs' law, from Gibbs' equations, that we have to remember and go back and use, because these are integrals of Cp dt over T with reference to some temperature, and so we use the S naught terms instead. So there's a lot of things you have to keep track of given early over this table. So you get it to a point where you get S2 minus S1, but how do you find S2 minus S1? Tables don't have S2 and S1. You have to use your relationship. So the tables have S naughts for air. One more quick example as we go through. Any questions on that before I do an unsteady second law? All right. Problem 6130. And this is uniform flow, uniform state, but it's unsteady analysis. Problem 6130. A 0.4 cubic meter rigid tank is filled with saturated liquid water, 200 degrees Celsius. A valve at the bottom of the tank is now open to 1/2 of the total mass that was drawn from the tank in the liquid form. Heat is transferred to water from a source at 250 degrees Celsius so that the temperature in the tank remains constant. Ooh, so it's isothermal. Determine the amount of heat transfer and B, the total entropy change for the process. All right, so we have a tank. There's a valve. We have some mass out. We have some heat transfer in. We have some surrounding temperature. We're given, so it's a tank that's emptying, so it feels like an unsteady problem. We're given that's H2O. We're given temperature surroundings. Given the volume. At state one, we're told it's saturated liquid at a certain temperature, and that gives us everything we need to know about that state. It gives us the internal energy, the entropy, and the specific volume. At state two, we're told that mass two equals 1/2 mass one, and that T2 equals T1, that is isothermal. And we're asked to find the heat transfer in, 1 to 2, and the entropy generated in the process. We can assume that it's uniform flow and uniform state, and there are negligible changes to kinetic and potential energy. You do a mass balance. The mass out equals M1 minus M2. And M1, we can find, equals the volume over the specific volume. We know M2 equals 1/2 of M1. And so we can get the mass that leaves the system, just based on problem definition. We start with certain mass, The sun has half that mass. The difference is the mass of light. This energy balance, energy in minus energy out equals energy two, let's say two minus energy one. But we can't say that E2 equals E1 because it's not a steady problem, it's an unsteady problem. We have heat transfer in from 1 to 2 minus the mass that goes out and the enthalpy that goes with it equals M2 U2 minus M1 U1. Just looking at the internal energy of the system. And we can get U2 from T2 and V2. We can find these, and by the way, what leaves is saturated liquid at 200 degrees Celsius. The liquid comes out at the bottom of the tank. And so we can find the Qn from 1 to 2 equals a positive number. That heat is added to keep it isothermal. So we find Q is not zero. And that is positive. And that's important. We need to know the direction for the second law. For the second law, change in entropy for the control volume equals the entropy in minus entropy out plus the Q in over the temperature in plus the entropy that's generated. That means the entropy that's generated, just doing some math for now, equals S2 minus S1, the control volume, plus S out minus Sin minus Qn over T of the surroundings. The S out minus Sin, this is from the mass flow, the entropy that comes in and out with the mass. But what's S2 or S1 of the control volume? Well, that's just M2 S2 minus M1 S1, little S1, just by definition of the terms, plus M out S out. There is no S in term. Minus Qn over temperature of the surroundings. In this case, the S out equals S in the liquid phase, or the liquid edge of the saturation at 200 degrees Celsius. So we know that when you open the tank, it's the liquid part of the saturated mixture that comes out. So that means your enthalpy that comes out has the enthalpy of the saturated liquid. It means the entropy that comes out has the entropy of the saturated liquid. So we can find SL out. We can get S2 from T2 equals T1 and V2 equals, that's the specific volume, equals the volume over mass 2 equals 2V1. So we can find the specific volume of state 2 from the mass in the rigid volume, and then we can also find the temperature because it's isothermal. Once we know temperature and specific volume, we can find state 2. It's a mixture at state 2. And then once we know it's a mixture, we know the equality of state 2 equals V2 minus VL over VLV, and S2 equals SL plus the quality of state 2 times SLV. The entropy is just a property like enthalpy or internal energy, things like that. So once we know the quality, we can find the entropy as well. The S generation must be greater than zero because we know that temperature of the source is greater than the temperature of the water. So we're given that actually in the problem definition as well. That was fast. I want to show you an unsteady example. It's a similar process as everything we've done before. We have to understand your assumptions, your givens, your mass balance, your energy balance.
Then you do your second law analysis. Your second law analysis has several forms, whether it's rate basis or not rate basis. And you might have to use some of the Gibbs relations if it's got changes in enthalpy and you don't have Tappeter information. Any questions on any of that? This is where the problems start getting a lot harder, I think. There's a lot more to include you. All right, get out early. You guys have a great weekend. We'll see you Monday.
Whatever.
Yeah.